Hello, welcome to this course COC 4010, that is on information security. This first video lecture will be the introduction to the information security. In this video, I will be covering what is information, what is the purpose of information, what is security. InfoSec is the short for information security. And then I'll talk about the security goals, chiefly CIA Triad, and one more model, which is not in the book, but I'll be just giving a reference to it because that is also an accepted model. In the second lecture, I'll be talking about OSI security architecture, security attacks, security mechanisms and services, and model of network security. So in this video, we'll be looking at the first three things. What is information? So anything that conveys some meaning. Anything means any sequence of symbols. And those symbols could be the sequence of alphabets and the special characters. It could be the binary sequencing, it could be the genetic sequencing, it could be the biometric, whether it be in the form of a book that is saved on a computer system or whatever. If it is conveying some meaning, if it is relevant to some subject, if it is valuable and can be used as a commercial product, it is an information. And information in today's world, because this is the information age, information about every aspect of one's life, information about the every aspect of one's organization can be electronically represented in nowadays. For example, if I talk about the Aadhaar cards, while registering for the Aadhaar, you must have given your biometric information, the iris scan, the fingerprints and everything. They have maintained a database out of it. So these are the personal data that identifies your identity, that uniquely identifies who you are, relate you to an Aadhaar number, and whenever you go in order to buy a SIM card or any such services where your identity has to be proven, you have to punch your biometrics there, which is then compared with the database, and then you're identified. So that information is relevant to us. It has got a context to it. If we take the example of a banking system, then in a banking system, we may say that we have got accounts in the banks, and if I want to check for my balance, if I have made a transaction and I want to check what amount of balance is left in my account, then I expect that information to be accurate as well. Take the example of Aadhaar. I went to buy something, I want to prove my identity, they asked me for the Aadhaar number, I gave them my Aadhaar number. Now they will ask me to, you know, for my biometrics. My biometrics should be available, that is one of the things. It should be accurately available, so that it compares and verifies me and I get the services. So information is supposed to be relevant in some context. It can be valuable as it can generate money commercially. It should be accurate and it should be available whenever required. And these things are very important because information is covering almost every aspect of our day-to-day life. The main concern with the information being so widely present is the security. And security literally is defined as the state of being free from danger or threat. Since information is present on the computer systems, it is vulnerable. It is open to the attacks. It is open to the threats. The difference between threat and attack is the attack is an assault on the system security. It is an active thing that has taken place. And threat is a possible potential for violation of security, right? So I want to be free not only just from the attacks, but also from the potential of being attacked and compromising my information. So I need security. Cybersecurity is a term coined for computer systems where the computer systems are there and they are designed in such a way that they protect you from the theft or damage to their hardware, software or electronic data, as well as from the disruption or misdirection of the services they provide. Misdirection of services means that you are entitled for a service, but somebody else is getting that service. In real world, if we talk about you have got money in your wallet, but somebody else is using it to buy things, which is not acceptable, right? So in cyber world, when you have a data stored on a computer system, you don't want others to use it. You need to have security. So cyber security includes the computer security. And now when you're transmitting that data from one system to another system on the internet, that data passes from different networks, different routers that are not in your control. And therefore, while the message is passing from a different networks, it has to be secured from external intrusions. And that is called as network security. So protecting your system, computer system alone, might involve operating system security, which is covered in Unit 3. And while it is being propagated onto a network and a security is provided to it, that is termed as network security. And we'll talk about that in the Unit 4 about the protocols dealing with it. But currently, we'll be focusing on the cryptographic techniques that are being developed and evolved over a period of time after this lecture. Information security says that it is the practice of preventing or at least reducing the probability of unauthorized, inappropriate access to data or the unlawful use, disclosure, disruption, deletion, corruption, modification, inspection, recording, or devaluation of information. You can find this definition on the Wikipedia. So information security encompasses so many things, and if I talk about the crux of it, then the crux is that it says that you have got information available on digitally onto the computer systems. It may pass through the network. What you want is confidentiality, the privacy. Your information should not be exposed to everybody else who are not the intended users. You want the accuracy of that information. You don't want anybody modifying that information. You don't want anybody deleting that information. And you want information whenever you require them to be, if you are authorized to get it. So there should be no disruption in you getting that information. If I take the real world example, which is discussed in one of the books that is in the references, it says that one of the aspects is that you have got a money in your purse and you can use that money to buy things of your interest. But somebody else is trying to have an access onto your purse and use their money to buy the things. Is it desirable for you? And a stranger is trying to do this. It is not. You want to keep your money confidential to yourself. So that is one of the goals that you are looking at. You want your money to yourself so that you can spend it in order to buy things. Another aspect could be that you are in a foreign land. Your bank has the money. Now you want that money in a foreign land. If you are denied that money, then how would you survive? So if you have got money, it should be available to you whenever you need it. And availability also includes that it should be available in the format that makes sense to you. If you are in some other country and you need dollars over there, then you want your bank to deliver the currency after converting it into the dollars and not in rupees. So it should be in the correct format as well. Thirdly, if you want to withdraw the money, then that money should be in real currency notes, not the fake notes. And therefore, the integrity of money should be maintained. It is not like that you should be getting the Children's Bank of India rupee notes instead of Reserve Bank of India mark. So integrity, confidentiality, and availability are three chief goals that we'll be looking at. And this forms the CIA triad. C stands for confidentiality, that says message should be hidden from the unauthorized access. Any unauthorized person should not have access to your information. Integrity says the message should be protected from the unauthorized change. That means message can be modified, but the modification can take place only through the authorized person. Availability means that the message should be available to the authorized person whenever needed. So confidentiality can be mapped to the real world scenario as, you know, you can think about a locker. So you have got some confidential papers or your property papers and you have kept that inside a locker and you have logged it. Anybody who tries to have an access to those papers, property papers, should have the key to that locker, right? So authorized person must be having the key, and when that key is applied, when that password is given, then only it will be accessible. If I talk in the terms of the logic and the electronic data, then the example is in military. The information is very sensitive in case of in the military system. So you don't want your message to be exposed to the maybe lower hierarchy. You don't want your message to be exposed to the adversaries, because that may lead to serious damages in banking system. The authorized access of a manager is almost over the entire banking system of his bank. But an employee who is sitting on a particular desk may have very limited access to the databases. Similarly, a person cannot see my account transactions and my account balances. If I am looking, I can get mine, but I cannot get into the others. So there is an access limitation for every user of the banking system. So in this way, they maintain the confidentiality. In industry, you want to hide the information from your competitors. Again, confidentiality is required. Confidentiality is very, similar to privacy, but there is a slight difference that I'll be talking about in the coming slides. So confidentiality basically means that unauthorized person should not have access to the information. And how can you do that? So you can categorize your information into various categories. And then based on the correct categories, you can give permissions that, okay, this category can be a public domain category, so everybody can use it. This particular category of information is very sensitive, and therefore it should be, shared with a limited number of people. So you can prepare an access list of who can view that information, or you can give the permissions to it, or you can encrypt it. You can use, IDs and passwords and two-factor authentication to make the information readable for the people who have got that information, right? You can encrypt that information. You can use huge keys, and those keys are only available with the people who are authorized to get that information. So that is how you can go about it. Now, confidentiality, the one thing to note over here is, when I'm talking about computer security, the file is in the computer system, and nobody should have an access to that file because I have set my permissions and passwords onto that file. Authorized person can have it. So that is that confidentiality just not applies to the storage, but it also applies to the transmission. If I am transmitting that file over a network, now it comes into the domain of the network security. In network security also, confidentiality is required. Intruder should not be able to read the message being conveyed from source to destination. Integrity. Data integrity, as I said earlier, you cannot modify the data. So protecting data from modification by unauthorized parties is your integrity. But the thing here is that if you are authorized to modify it, you cannot modify it randomly, and you cannot leave the state into an inconsistent state. There has to be an authorized mechanism through which you can make the changes into the system, right? Or modify the information. For example, user account controls should not be modifiable. So user account control is a personal thing to a user, and therefore nobody should be given a right to modify those controls, because if I have got that right, and if I'm, not happy with that user, I may change the rights of that user, and that user would not be able to do anything at all. Right? So it could be detrimental. Certain information should not be modifiable at all. So how can you do it? You can make things read only. You can have an access to it, but you cannot modify it. Other files, as we have seen in the case of confidentiality, can be given, certain permissions, and based on that, limited number of people have an access to it, and then they can make changes to the system. But the important thing here is that sometimes, if I'm an authorized person, I have an access to the databases or any important information, and by mistake I delete it, there is an accidental modification which may hamper significantly organization or an individual. So there was a company, when they were updating their systems, by mistake they deleted their database. So they were authorized to make changes to the databases, and by mistake, accidentally, they deleted it. So this accidental modification caused significant losses. So one thing over here that is important is that the modification should be reversible. It can be made reversible when we have got backups. Then we can say, okay, we did a mistake, but we are, rolling back to a previous state. So backup could be of help over there, or we can have version controls. We save the previous version, we modify it. If the modification is not stable, we switch back to the previous version. Now this way, integrity could be implemented. The last one is availability. Availability means that the data should be readily available whenever needed by the authorized person. And why is that required? Because information is something that keeps on changing rapidly. You did a transaction in the bank, your balance changes. When your balance changes, then the authorized person, whether it be a human or a computer system, should make the necessary changes immediately, right? So that information should be available for that authorized person to make the changes. So availability is also very important. You deposit certain amount of money, but it never got updated onto the system. That means you lost that money. So unavailability of the services can also cause huge damages. And therefore, we have to have, you know, system in place to make the resources available to us 24/7. Again, if I go to the banking example, I say that I go to the ATM and I want the cash, I should be able to get the cash out of it. Maybe I need it emergently during the night time and I need to have it. I want to do an online transaction which is on a very urgent basis. I should have the access to the bank and do a transaction online at any time I want. Now imagine you went to buy a SIM card. There they want your Aadhaar biometrics identification and their server is down. You are punching your biometrics over and over again, but it is not getting, you know, verified from the databases because their server is down, their services are unavailable. So pretty much you won't be able to prove your identity and you won't get the services that you need. Therefore, availability is one of the major factors that has to be considered, and if not provided, it may cause damages equivalent to the damages caused by the breach of security in terms of confidentiality or integrity. And how can you do that? So you should have backups in place. If one of the resources is not responding or is down because of the power outages or whatever reason may be, then there should be an alternative resource with the same information so that that alternative can provide the information to the customers whenever needed, right? Or you can create high availability clusters. So again, this leads to the redundancy of the data because you are basically mirroring the same information over to the different systems in the different geographical locations, so that if one system is down because of any reason, other system should be providing you the access and the information and the services, everything. So high availability clusters can have dedicatedly designed in a way that they counter the power outages problem, they counter the denial of service attack kind of a problem, or if I'm talking about the transmission of file from one source to the destination, it moves through different networks. If one of the network is down because of a power outage or because of whatever reason, so I should have an alternative path towards the destination. So there should be multiple network routes available. So depending upon the kind of requirement that you have, you can design your high availability clusters in order to make information available to the customers. Now you will see that CIA TRIDE is basically focusing on information confidentiality, information integrity, information availability. It doesn't focus on many other factors that are there. So there is one model which is called as RMIAS model, or the full form is a reference model of information assurance and security. Now in this model, if you see, there are four quadrants, and these four quadrants basically cover different kind of information, and one of the quadrant is security goals that we have seen previously. We have seen three goals: confidentiality, availability and integrity, but it has five more goals. So that means eight goals which are necessary, and we'll talk about them. So in short, if I say what is information taxonomy, let's start from this quadrant. Information taxonomy means that it is describing about the information being protected and its life cycle from creation to the destruction, right? So it tells you that what kind of information it is. Is it electronic information? Sorry. Is it an electronic information, or is that information present on the paper, or is it a verbal information? It also tells you the location of that information from where it has been generated, because based on the location you will have different legal policies that would be required, right? And the sensitivity level of that information in order to, you know, put in place the proper permissions of who can access and who cannot, right? So all such information is included in the information taxonomy. Then this quadrant 2 is about security goals that has five more goals and which will be looking in greater detail, so I'm not paying attention right now. Then comes your security measures. So based on the kind of goals you are looking for, there are certain countermeasures that you have to take place. Based on these scores, you have to decide that technically what cryptographic algorithms would be required, or they would be required at all or not. What kind of authentication and authorization would be required. Based on the goals, there may be a chance that the countermeasures are human-oriented, where training and ethics and culture and motivation is required. Now, ethics, if I talk about ethics in a greater detail, then one of the ethics is that I cannot use the images, random images in my presentation. If I'm using this image, then definitely I have not created this image. So ethics says that I should not copy somebody else's work, but still I'm using this image. And what is the reason behind it? So what I did is, when I was searching for the RMIS model in the Google, so there was an option here, usage rights, where it gave me 5 options, not filtered by license. That means it will show me all the images that are present on the network, labeled for reuse and with modification. That means I can reuse an image and I can modify it as well. If it is under this license, I can reuse it. I have searched for labeled for reuse, any image that could be reused. So I'm reusing this image in my slides, and labeled for non-commercial reuse with modification, and labeled for non-commercial reuse. Non-commercial means that you should not have monetary gains out of the information that you are using through this license, right? If I am searching it on the Bing, that is provided by Microsoft, then I can have all Creative Commons, public domain, free to share and use, free to share and use commercially, free to modify, share and use, free to modify, share and use commercially. So it gives me the list of those photographs or pics that could be used even commercially. But I'm going for the Creative Commons option, and I'm creating Creative Commons, I'm getting this image over here. Now, what does this Creative Commons says? Anything that is there under the Creative Commons license, then I am free to share, that is, I can copy, distribute and transmit that work, and I can adapt the work. I can mix it with some other work. I can modify it under the following conditions. Number one, attribution and share alike. That whatever new work you have created, you should have the same Creative Commons licensing under it. You cannot make it private or under any other licensing. So this is one of the requirements in share alike. And attribution means that you should refer to the person who created it. You must give appropriate credits. So if you see, then in this particular image, I'm giving the source and the credit of that person who has created it. After I'm giving this information, I can use the image under Creative Commons. So this is one of the ethics. I said that there are certain things that I'll be telling you along the lectures that will be under the ethics criteria, but they are not explicitly mentioned in the books. So this is one part of ethics. And then this security development lifecycle, which basically talks about the modification or the creation of the whole paradigm and then its retirement after its use. Let's talk about security goals. So confidentiality, integrity and availability we have talked about. Now comes the accountability. Accountability means that you can hold the user responsible for his or her action. Number two is privacy. Privacy and confidentiality, I said there is a thin line between them. So confidentiality says that the information should not be accessible to the unauthorized person. But privacy says that a person should have the power to control his or her information. So it enables the individuals to control their own information wherever feasible, right? So this is not a compulsion, but certain places we can have privacy as a goal as well. Auditability means that the actions are monitored, whether it be by machines or the humans. Non-repudiation means that if an event has occurred, if that event says that, okay, an event of a transaction has occurred between the bank and the customer, that neither of them can deny that the event did not occur, right? So this non-repudiation proves the occurrence or non-occurrence of an event. If non-repudiation says the event did not occur, then nobody can claim that the event occurred. For example, somebody borrowed 500 rupees from me, and later on I said, okay, give me my 500 rupees back. The person may say, no, I never take it from you. So he is denying an event that has occurred. So if with the help of a third party, if I can prove the non-repudiation that the occurrence of the event has taken place, that means that person is at fault and he should give me 500 rupees back, right? Then authentication and trustworthiness is that you are able to verify the identity of the person who is either creating the message or who is either reading the message, or you can identify a third party whether it's trustworthy or not, and then accordingly you can decide whether you want to have the services from that third party or you want to have the information from third party or not, right? So all these five additions have been made to the security goal through the reference model for information assurance and security. For OSI architecture, I'll be making a separate video, so thank you for now.